Is there any hope for the GIS career path? And this is a pretty big topic, but one I've wanted to dive into for a while, as I get a lot of messages from individuals at all stages of their careers, beginners, people in late stage of their career, in the middle of their career in GIS, wondering, what's the outlook for me? And what can I expect from the rest of my time in GIS? And it's a fair question. I think there's a lot floating around, and I've tried to study this myself around what are the salary expectations? What should you be focusing in on in terms of skills or management or any of these different areas? And what do you really need to be doing to start to advance your career if that's what you want to do? Look, GIS is an exciting field. I think we all know that by participating in it. But at the same time, when you compare salaries across comparable roles in data roles, such as GIS analyst versus data analyst, there is a pretty noticeable disparity. I've figured out that that's somewhere around $20,000 US, if you look at it that way, but sometimes can be even greater. So how do we start to break this apart? So what I want to start to look at today is the reality of GIS salaries, what's really out there, some of the data that I have initially. Why are some roles paying more than others? What's the difference between the geospatial GIS roles that are out there and what can you expect? How you can differentiate yourself and what you can do to kind of start to control that. And then if you want to, how do you start to move into these different higher paying jobs or roles for things like that? Now let's look at some of the data around entry level GIS roles. These roles can pay anywhere from $40,000 to $60,000 a year. And I don't want to speak for anyone to say if that's high, low, in between, but that's sort of the reality of what you're looking at for a entry-level GIS analyst role. And I think even within that, some people can kind of feel stuck at that $70,000 to $80,000 a year mark in GIS. And that's generally what my data shows. I put a link here if you want to check out some of the data that I pulled, is that there is this kind of ceiling in terms of what you can expect from a GIS salary, especially if you're looking at it from an individual contributor role, being that you're the person doing the work, you're not managing a person or a team or anything like that. So that's kind of the range of what you might be looking at. And if you look at a lot of the academic programs, a lot of them added this kind of like career outlook, salary outlook tracker on their websites, that kind of reflects what you see there is that kind of $70,000, $80,000, $90,000 a year mark in terms of what you can expect from salary. Now, it varies, of course, by where you are in the country. And of course, I'm talking about my experience in the United States, and that definitely differs from different countries and things like that. But overall, that's kind of what you can expect. And if I'm speaking in very general terms, that's a sort of middle of the ground salary in terms of what you can expect, especially if you're comparing it to other technical roles. Now, if you look at similar technical roles, if you take like a data analyst versus a GIS analyst or a GIS engineer versus a data engineer, and I'm kind of trying to compare as close as I can apples to apples, which isn't ever perfect, but there is this difference around $20,000 to $30,000 between these roles. Now, that's not absolute. Some jobs will pay more on one side versus the other. And of course, there are jobs that don't pay great on the data side as well. But generally, there's this difference between those. And that can be difficult if you're looking at that and saying, well, why am I doing that? And if I had to produce an answer to why there's that difference, I think GIS is looked at as a technician role rather than a strategic role. What do I mean by that? Now, what I mean by a technician, what do we mean by that term? A technician is someone that is very much fitting into a process, fitting into a role, and performing that role. You know the job to be done. It's laid out for you. You're kind of the person moving the data through, pushing the buttons, making the sausage, if you will. That's kind of how that term technician is thought of, at least for me. And I could be wrong, and I'm open to hearing other opinions, but that's a major limiting factor if you start to think about it that way. When you look at strategic, or the term that's kind of associated with data science or things like that, it's not just, you know, creating the sausage or building the dashboards or doing those types of things. You're thinking critically about what's going in there. And it's not to say that if you're in a GIS role and if you're in this one of these technician roles, you're not thinking strategically. I know that you are. It's just the perception and the view sometimes about how these things break out. And usually if you want to sort of start to scale up and build, you want to move into these more strategic functions, right? There's something that hasn't been solved that is a problem, and you need to go out there and figure out how to solve it rather than simply executing on something that you know is taking place already. And I'm sure there's parallels to the data analyst and the data science world, but at least speaking from the geospatial world, when we want to move into those strategic levels, those are some of the things that need to happen. Now, why some jobs pay more than others? Part of that does come down to skills, right? These are technical skills. If you look at, you know, even in the data analyst world, learning Excel versus learning Python or SQL, there's probably a pay bump associated with that there. You could kind of compare that to knowing a desktop GIS versus a technical toolkit. There's probably a pay bump there. And with those technical skills, you do achieve some flexibility to deploy those in more strategic ways, right? You can use those to scale up and do different things. It gives you a little bit more flexibility to work on some of those more, components or problems that haven't been solved. So there is a skill component to this. It's not to say that if you learn cloud, you're going to massively accelerate your career chances, because that varies depending on what you want to do. But if I had to kind of give you a bread and butter guess of what I would do, I would pump one part of that, and one part would be the technical skills, right? Now, I think Python and SQL, as I've said before, skills that are worth learning and can help you either in GIS or in moving into a different career path if that's what you choose to do. They're good skills to have, I think, regardless anywhere. But it's just one component, right? You also have to bring in some of that strategic thinking. So what does that mean from a technical perspective? Understanding architectural choices. When should I use one language versus the other? When should I move things into the cloud and not? How can I build a system that can solve problem X, right? These are some of the things you want to start to be thinking about when you're looking to scale up and move into these different roles that will ultimately probably help you accelerate your career growth. Now, this is all kind of based on data, right? This is hard to apply it to everyone's personal experience, right? If you look at the data for job roles, these are the numbers that you get back, but it's not perfect, right? This is not to say if you learn cloud, you're immediately getting these salaries. There's a whole other component to this that is about you as the job candidate. And this is where that positioning piece comes into it, right? For if we like it or not, if you're applying for a new job or trying to grow in your career or trying to advance in the job you currently have, a lot of it comes down to how you position yourself and how you are showing your skills in the organization and really your impact and what you're doing. So, and this is where that technician trap starts to come into place. If you're kind of, you know, if you look at you're that technician, the support role, the person that's helping the things that already exist, that's kind of where you sit. And that's kind of your positioning, is I work on systems and keep them up and running. Whereas if you have a unique value proposition of saying, I can use technology X and Y to solve problem Z, that becomes a bigger, you know, value proposition. You can apply that strategically and do those different things. So start to look at those areas where you can start to position yourself. You can also bring in subject matter expertise. I know many of us have very specific interests in different things. You know, what are those for you, and how do you want to solve them? And how can you take a technology and pair that with a personal interest? How can you apply that with spatial thinking and maybe even some, you know, spatial statistical techniques if you've taken some of the advanced, you know, learning paths or done some of those different things. And many of those things are available to you in even a desktop GIS. So how can you start to weave that together to tell your story a little bit more strategically? I think that's a big piece of messaging that I've missed and I haven't talked about enough, but using those other skills to say, I'm not just a person helping the machine keep moving, problem solver, I'm strategic, and here's the knowledge and the skills I use to do that, and start to weave that story together. That's really where you can start to make some of that magic happen and start to showcase why you matter more and ultimately help you move into those places that you want to be. And it's not to say that this is simply something that's just for a career jump. If you want to switch jobs, you can do this inside of your own job and start to find and apply those different skills, you know, advocate for yourself, decide what you want to do, you know, kind of try to move into some different projects or things like that, and really accelerate what you want to do within that. And positioning and showing that is one big piece. It takes all these pieces together, building blocks, technical skills, your kind of will and drive, your positioning, all those things together can really start to help you accelerate that. And you can work on these problems, you know, as a practitioner. It's not to say that you have to move into management. That's kind of the traditional path. If you think of GIS, is that you're, you know, kind of the person doing the support, then maybe you're helping others, then you're managing. You can be the person that can be the problem solver there too, and start to move into those different areas like that. Now, if I had to take a few baby steps to do this myself, what would I start to do? Well, I think build you know, the traditional advice, I should say, is build an online portfolio, which is great. It takes a lot of work and energy, especially if you want to make it look good, which a lot of us, I mean, if you have any background in cartographic design, you know, you have an eye for design and you want to make things look good. It's not to say don't build an online portfolio. I think online portfolios are great, but use LinkedIn. I mean, if you're trying to showcase to more people what you can do, LinkedIn is an excellent place to do that. And you can show your work. I mean, a post is just as good as posting something on a website. Plus more people can see it, you can engage, get feedback, and you can engage with others and see what others are doing as well. There's a massive community there. That's why I enjoy it. It's actually seeing what other people are doing. Spend a lot of time doing that and getting ideas and things that I haven't thought about. So use LinkedIn and kind of maybe start to use that as your portfolio, like a living portfolio rather than just a static page that says, here's these projects that I've built. And don't hold back. Don't feel like you need to wait to post anything. You can certainly do that and move those along. And then start to get involved in conversations, right? Learn what other people are doing. See how you could apply that. See how other people are doing things strategically and start to think through those different areas. So, you know, it's a combination of these pieces, right? But I think having and you know, using these tools to kind of test your positioning, but also build it, and you can even refine it as it goes over time, is a great, great asset. So I've talked a lot about technical skills. If you've, you know, seen my content at any given time, I talk about Python. I talk about Spatial SQL. I talk about, you know, cloud native GIS. I talk about modern GIS. I talk about all these things. Very important, right? Having the right technical background to solve these problems is good. But you also have to showcase how you can do those things strategically. Think how the pieces can start to fit together, right? When do you use these things together? And then most importantly, how do I use my new toolkit to solve a problem that hasn't been solved before? That's step one, tools, problem solving. Step two is create that strategic positioning for yourself. You are not just a technician. You are not just a support system. You are a problem solver. And if you are, you know, if any of you have gone through a GIS or a geography program or anything like that, you think about problems spatially. That's a major, huge asset. Apply that now to create that positioning for yourself in your organization. And that's a huge asset out in the wider job market as well. You think about things differently than most people do. So how can you use those tools to start to build the career that you want and really start to elevate your GIS path? That's, I think, the recipe to start to grow. And I put this out today because I get this question all the time. I want to grow. I want to be in this industry and I want to advance my career. So this is kind of my simple blueprint to start to do that. And it's not to say that you have to then go out and build 15 portfolio projects and do all this. Try to do this inside of the day-to-day work that you're doing, right? And doing those different things. Now, of course, there comes challenges with how do I learn these skills and how do I start to create my positioning and all of that? And how do I start to build my, you know, think of myself as this strategic person, right? Those are all different challenges that we can continue to discuss, but I wanted to at least get those pieces out there, right? Is there, and what is the path for your GIS kind of career and progression? And those are the elements that I would say if you're just starting to think about, that's where I spent some time digging. So I hope this was helpful. Like I said, I get questions about this all the time. So I figured it was worth dropping some thoughts on. I'd love to hear your feedback. If you're, depending on where you're watching this, you know, there's different ways to comment and share and talk about those different things, but I'd love to hear what challenges you're facing. Have you done this successfully? What skills are you learning? And, you know, more importantly, how could I be helpful there? So if you're on a platform that can comment, please do. And I'd love to hear your thoughts.